to the Cathedral of Shadows, where demons gather.
Hello everyone, welcome to the Cathedral of Shadows and Megami Tensei Podcast. I'm Rasen.
I'm Katsu.
And it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. It's snowing outside, and it's
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
Please send blankets. Actually, it's warm as fuck by you still, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, fucking Florida garbage weather assholes. Don't have to drive in the snow. Don't have to fight polar bears on your way to work.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's been a lot of news that's just kind of sort of accumulated over the past couple of weeks that we thought we'd talk about, and it's nothing too major, but just a lot of little stuff, maybe some things you might have missed if you weren't paying keen attention like we do. So we thought we'd just kind of sit down and talk about some stuff. Well, I guess before that, is there anything you've been playing, Katsu?
I've been playing that Final Fantasy XIV. I'm loving the game a lot, but that's about what all I've been playing all month. My subscription's gonna run out soon, so I'm trying to crunch in time.
The struggle.
Yes.
Trying to play as much as you can before you can't anymore, and then you just cry.
Yeah.
Man. And then, well, good thing your subscription's running out, because then in 11 days, as of this recording, it's going to be time for Persona Q to come out in North America.
Yes, Persona Q.
It's finally going to come out. It's pretty exciting. I'm pretty excited myself. Less than 2 weeks. Good stuff. I don't know, but I have a feeling that you can still probably get the Wildcard Edition, maybe, if you're
quick about it.
If you're quick. I don't know if they still have them available, to be honest, but I didn't see anything saying that they don't, so I'm assuming they are, because generally when an edition like that runs out, they just go, oh, we don't have it anymore, so sorry. And I didn't see any messages like that, so I'm assuming they're still out there. So yeah, pre-order the Wildcard Edition now if you still want that. I'm getting it. Because why not? It's 30 extra, and hey, yeah. I have money to spend. So, yeah, that's happening, and I guess speaking of Persona and what I've been playing, I beat Persona 4 not too long ago, and now I'm on a strange journey.
Yes, he's on Bizarre Adventure.
I know, it took me long enough to finally actually sit down. I am probably the only person that has played, like, I want to say a solid 8 to 9 games to completion before getting to Persona 4 in my MegaTen game playing cycle. Not the only person, but like, it's not too common in the English fan base. But it's kind of weird. I feel like this weird full cycle thing where I started with Persona 3, or at least that was the first one I took seriously, and I got all the way now to Persona 4 after playing a shit ton of the other games, and man, I don't know. Persona 4 is relaxing, I'll say that. It's a
nice break from the hardcore, dark and edgy.
Yeah.
So dark it makes you want to kill yourself edge that MegaTen is known for and that all the fans like.
Yeah, it's, I will say that, like, the game has this weird false sense of abruptness. I don't know how else to describe it, but, like, it's relaxing and it doesn't really take too much effort to get from point A to point B. The game is still pretty damn long, so like I was like, oh, I'm glad I'm playing this one, like when the semester is starting to get a little more rough, and then I'm like, I'm still actually wasting a lot of time with this game. So yeah, it's long. I think I want to say I had like a 70-75 hour ish somewhere around their save game for my first playthrough. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I did get the true ending, so there is, I guess, just a bit of stuff I want to talk about with that, because I don't know, it's just kind of fresh on my mind. Like, I feel like Persona 4 is, from like a development and design standpoint, just this really weird experience in that it's really consistent. Like, there's not really too many points where it, like, just flops or, like, I'd say even gets amazing, but it's just really good all the way through. And you don't get many games like that. They tend to be a little more jagged with the quality. Just all the way through Persona 4, I'm like, this is a pretty smooth ride. Even Persona 3, the way I wrote about it on Twitter is, like, Persona 3, in my opinion, is just, like, a fucking amazing game, but then there are times where, like, it just kind of shits the bed. And, like,
like December.
And you kind of just need to lean over and pretend you don't, like, smell it and just kind of hope the shit doesn't get near you. Yeah, like, December, especially. But Persona 4 never really shits the bed. It just kind of lays there and
just rolls around a bit.
Rolls around a bit, and then, like, yeah. That's,
and then gets comfortable.
And then you're laying down having a good old time. And Persona 3, it's like doing jumping jacks, and then sometimes it takes a little poo, and you gotta have a conversation with Persona 3 about what it just did and why it's wrong. Portable kind of helps some of that, and depending on your taste in storytelling and just, I guess, presentation, maybe takes away a bit. But I guess the big question that everyone's going to fucking ask, and oh my god, I can't wait to get to the comment section on this one. I think I like Persona 3 better. I think part of it too is I'm more willing to forgive games that have really great ideas, but they fuck up the execution every once and again. And I think that's kind of Persona 3, where, damn, what a good game. But yeah, like I'm sorry, the total party control thing not being there, that's just fucking stupid. Just not the most fun to play back through, especially after you play through other MegaTen stuff where the total party control is so necessary and such a key element to it. Oh, man. But, there is actually one thing that... The only other thing I really, I guess, want to talk about with Persona 4 is... I felt this really, really weird reaction that just... I haven't, I guess, seen too many people talk about, like... I guess Persona 4 spoiler. We don't fucking care about spoilers. Anyways, a lot of people like to talk about the scene where Nanako seems to die, and then you have to decide whether or not to throw Namatame into the TV or not. And a lot of people really talk about whether or not that scene is kind of having its cake and eating it too, type of thing, where Nanako's actually fine, but oh, they want you to feel upset and all that. And just, I was kind of thinking about that throughout the whole... Even before that scene, throughout that whole experience, there's a lot of scenes where just... And I feel like I'm going to piss someone off. There's a lot of scenes where it really feels like Nanako is kind of shoved in your face just a little bit. Like...
So, yeah, I feel the same way. Like, there are some times... Like, before Nanako gets admitted to the hospital, she pops up in, like, social links with the investigation team quite a bit.
Even if you don't do hers, she appears in others.
She appears in Yukiko's, Shie's, I don't think Yosuke's, Naoto's, she appears in Naoto's. If you do her social link quick enough, Nanako will show up. I don't think Kanji, I might be remembering wrong.
I don't remember for Kanji, to be honest.
Yeah. But yeah, she appears in other people's social links and stuff. I mean... It's perfectly fine that she appears in Dojima's, because, you know, that's kind of a thing.
That makes sense.
That makes sense in the context.
It'd actually be weird if she didn't, to be honest. But, see, the thing with that was just... That bothered me. And, like, I really like Nanako as a character, and I think she's cool and all that, but there was just... I think it also helps if you do her social link, because it does flesh her out quite a bit more and makes her a little bit more relatable and all that, but holy shit, in some of those story scenes, it feels just like they're fishing for that emotional connection to be made so hard, and I really feel like it's just kind of... There are some points where I feel like the writers are saying, oh, you're just supposed to love her because she's that...
You're supposed to love her because she's the kid, and she's
a cute little cousin, little sister, adorable kid that loves you and all that. I'm like, oh, okay. And like, one scene that really sticks out in my mind is where they have that food tasting competition thing. And Nanako's like, oh, it all tastes really good. And everyone's like, oh, that's my Nanako. And I'm like, oh my god, that is so fucking on the nose. Like, there's just a few points where I'm like, holy shit, they really, really want you to like Nanako. It's almost to the point where if I had played that game without being spoiled, I would have been able to easily tell that something was going to happen to Nanako.
Yeah.
Because they try so hard to get you to like her, and like, it's... Like I said, I like her, and I thought Nanako was a great character, but like, holy shit, they try really hard. They're not very subtle at all, honestly.
They tried so hard and gone so far.
And in the end, it didn't even matter because she came back to life.
Yep.
Yeah. And also, I guess the only other thing is the ending sequence was pretty cool. To be honest, though, nothing can fucking top the ascending to the moon and kicking Nyx in the dick in Persona 3. Holy shit. That was... But yeah, the whole thing with, like, your party member shoving you out of the way and all that, yeah, I think that's really well done, so... And I mean, it's one thing to, like, see that scene on YouTube or something, but then to have it happen...
Have it happen? It's just like, oh my god.
At the end of a 75-hour journey, and it's all of the social links that you did and all the people you talked to and all that, that's, you know, it's different.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was...
I like that sequel. I think it was really well executed.
Yeah. Also, I think the best fucking thing ever, I read this on the wiki, I never really paid attention to it or thought about it. If you don't max out any social link in the game, the only person that gives you backup is Teddy.
Yeah.
So it's literally Narukami, like, passes out, he hears Teddy's voice, and he's like, yo, I'm ready, I can do this. And he fucking goes Super Saiyan level 5, and then Myriad Truths, and then the game is done. I think that's hilarious how Teddy is... the only one that no matter what will have your back.
Yes.
Not even Nanako likes you that much.
Nanako's like, screw you.
Yeah. Oh, man. So, that's what I did in the past.
I personally think Golden made it even better. Just because the whole sequence was fully voiced. And you have a Dachi there. Just telling, just talking shit to you like he usually does.
Oh, actually, that's one last thing. I know I've said that like 3 times now. There's one last thing I wanted to talk about. So I played vanilla, one, mostly because I don't have a Vita, and two, I'm like, you know what? Vanilla is supposedly more balanced and just overall is more difficult, and like, that's, I'm a Megami Tensei fan. That's a kind of a big thing for me. Just fucking play Golden. There's no fucking point in playing vanilla if you have the option of playing Golden. Just... It's the difficulty kind of just goes away after the second dungeon, to the point where if you're playing Persona 4 for the difficulty, no matter what you do, you're going to be really fucking disappointed. Just enjoy it for what it is. Don't give a fuck about the difficulty. Just play Golden. Honestly, there's no point in playing vanilla to be completely upfront with you. So yeah, that's all I really had to say about that. Oh, my girlfriend's playing SMT4. That's a thing that's happening. Yeah, she just kind of was interested, and she's like, can I borrow it? And I'm like, sure. So, I think she just got to Tokyo. It's been kind of interesting just seeing how she's been, you know, just kind of, getting used to it and all that. And, you know, you get the average beginner comments of, holy fuck, this tutorial
is
hard.
This game is awful. This game is awful. It's too hard. 0 out of 5.
She apparently didn't have too much difficulty with the tutorial other than, like, the negotiation thing, which is just kind of straight-up RNG, and then you get a game over if you fail, because you die in 2 hits. And then after that, she was fine. Like, she really fucking hates Navarre. The first thing back I actually heard when she was playing was, she sent me a question asking if Navarre dies soon, and I'm like, he goes away, but he doesn't die.
Nobody liked Navarre. What was the point of him even being there?
This is a little shit. And then he comes back later in that side quest. That's literally it.
Yeah.
I think really, honestly, the only point he's in there is to show how much of a douchebag that a lot of the luxurers are. How, like,
yeah, I guess.
Entitled they are. That's been cool. She really likes it so far. She said it's just unique because she's mostly used to Final Fantasy and Dragon Quest. So, Yeah, that's been fun stuff on my end. And I was kind of weird timing because I'm like, man, I I know I should be playing other games that I haven't beaten yet, but I kind of want to replay SMT4. Because I've seen so many European people talking about their experience and going, man, I really love this part of the game and this. And I'm like, yeah, I do too. I want to experience it.
I don't, though. I'm done with that game. I got my compendium to, like, I think it's, like, 80-something percent complete.
That's a lot.
I'm burnt out on real Shin Megami Tensei games.
So yeah, that's just been a lot of fun for me. And also, it's like, okay, that temptation of New Game Plus is gone because she has it. And she's probably gonna have it for a couple hundred more hours. So, dear. And then also, this is just a little side note. Apparently, on the MegaTen subreddit, they decided to have a poll to decide who was the best Persona 3 or 4 waifu. And there's a little place where you could nominate another character. Someone nominated me, which I thought was fucking hilarious. Whoever did that, you're the best. And
you're the best.
I'm honored.
Around.
You're the Karate Kid, basically. Yes. So whoever the fuck did that, thanks. I guess. I doki-doki'd so hard when I saw that. I guess moving on just into outside of our bullshit and into actual news. This is something that actually I've been wanting to talk about for a while. I just didn't really have the time and also just talking with people. There is a Shin Megami Tensei 1 fan translation, or not fan translation, what am I talking about? Fan remake project that a couple people, it seems mostly like it was based out of the Megaten subreddit and Tumblr, like those two places. And they just kind of come together and they're trying to get going on just making a remake of the first game. They have a little bit of a small team gathered up. And then they asked if, you know, we could do anything on the podcast or whatever with it. And I just said, yeah, I'll send people your way. It looks promising. I don't know where they're at in development or just if they're still planning or what's going on with it. But hopefully something comes out of it. There's some information posted below, which in case you want to help out and contact them or in case you're just curious and want to check out what's going on with it. Hopefully it doesn't die or get C&D'd or anything. Atlus hasn't really been known to C&D fan stuff, though. Even translations, like they don't...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure John Harden's seen all that SMTF hype and
oh sure, definitely.
Yeah.
They're not gonna do anything about SMTF. I would be shocked. Yeah, even Innocent Sin's fan translation came out not too long after or around the time of the PSP release, and in an interview someone even brought it up to an Atlus employee and they're like, we don't care. Like, it's different enough, and we know people will buy it regardless and all that, so they're good on them for that. Unlike some companies where when they release an HD version of something for next-gen consoles, they go after the fan translators of a project that
they spent years deciphering the code of the game, putting in English text, making it available for people who really wanted that game but never got any news from said company.
It was so... The people that buy Final Fantasy Type Zero on the next generation consoles aren't going to, like... Those people are not going to be the same people that go, wait, I could just play the fan-translated PSP.
Yeah.
Like,
you play the fan-translated PSP version with the awful camera.
Yeah.
With the shitty PlayStation Portable graphics. Yes, I want to play that one.
There is... No, square you, silly. Anyways.
It doesn't even matter. I have the fan translation already. And I am getting the HD version because, yeah, I'm trash. And... I love Type Zero. That game is awesome. Sick.
So yeah, there's SMT1 fan project stuff going on, which is pretty hype. I think it's called Shin Megami Tensei Resurrection. I should know the name of things before I talk about them, but I've been busy. Sorry.
Sound like it's gonna be a real Shin Megami Tensei game.
A real SMT game.
Yes.
Made by the fans for the fans. So, moving on. This is the most anti-news that we've probably ever going to talk about, but I thought it was worth talking about just because it's SMT Cross Fire Emblem news to an extent.
I know! Gasp!
It's not even news, but just because it's SMT. If this was any other game, we wouldn't even talk about this, but it's SMT Cross Fire Emblem, so we probably should.
Yes.
So SMT Cross Fire Emblem was recently listed on a Nintendo financial report on upcoming projects. So it's like, hey, it's kind of, it's still alive. We didn't cancel it yet, guys. Yay. It's out there.
It's out there.
And I don't think it even has a year attached to it. The release is straight up just, we don't know. So
if Final Fantasy 15 comes out before then, oh my god, the release window for 15 is in sight. Square Enix is like, yeah, we got a rough estimate, and we'll probably tell you guys about it soon.
I don't see SMT Cross FE before 2016. I really don't. So yeah, it's maybe that's good news. Hopefully, maybe kind of, sorta.
Yeah.
Oh
man, can you just imagine the next trailer we see for that game? What if it's just like, just blows our freaking minds with how awesome it is?
That'd be cool. I just want to see what the game is like at this point.
I just want to see how these characters interact with each other.
It could be like 30 seconds. It could be like 30 seconds of cutscene or like 30 seconds of gameplay. I'd be fine.
If it was just like pre-rendered CGI, I'd be perfectly fine at this point.
You know, I would too, to be honest. I guess in terms of other Atlus stuff, they're going to be at a Sony event in early December in Las Vegas. So this is a
American event.
Yeah, Western audience in mind. So it's called.
And they're probably just going to show the Persona 5 trailer.
Yeah.
The same one for TGS and just slap like.
The American logo. Like,
ESRB logo.
The westernized the logos and all that and have the same trailer of Persona 5 that I saw at TGS. Because technically, someone pointed this out on the subreddit, I think. Technically, the PlayStation 4 version of Persona 5 has not been announced other than Japan.
Yeah.
We all know it's, let's be honest, we all know it's fucking coming, but like, technically it hasn't been announced yet.
They're probably just going to announce it there. Atlus is probably just going to either translate the text from the trailer, or they're just going to put subtitles on it, whichever.
I don't even think they will, because there's no dialogue, and I don't think they give enough of a fuck for the newspapers and all that.
Yeah, I guess.
So yeah, that's December 6th to the 7th in Las Vegas. It's called the PlayStation Experience event. So, what else could they possibly?
They're going to show like Citizens of Earth and all their other stuff that they're publishing.
I thought that was a 3DS game, or is it not?
No, it's coming to PS4, too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's a multi-plot game.
Alright.
But I think Sony just wants them to show off exclusives, so they might just show the Persona 5 TGS trailer.
Yeah, who knows. So
say, yeah, it's coming to PS4 in North America.
Hey.
Please be excited.
So yeah, look forward to that. It's probably not going to be too much. Don't get too excited. And then, this actually is incredibly recent news, as in, this happened about 20 minutes before we started recording. Atlus put out a video called the Persona Q Q&A video that's basically John Harden answering a bunch of questions about Persona Q that people sent in via Facebook and Twitter. Not gonna lie, I saw the posts on Twitter where they're like, hey, tweet us your questions using this hashtag, and I just kind of scrolled through and I'm like, wow, this video is gonna be the most basic questions. But actually, watching the video, they chose some pretty good questions to answer, and just overall, it's a good summary of
what to expect in the game.
Yeah, I think it answers the most big and general unknowns while also having enough information and being enough in-depth that there's a few things that even I hadn't really caught up with and kind of figured out. Like, there's a little bit in there where they talk about sub-personas and when you equip them, how they give, they might give, like, a little boost to HP or SP or something like that.
Yeah.
And how that's
shown
in game.
At all.
Yeah, I had no fucking clue that was even in the game. And I've been following this since like day one. So just little stuff like that. It was nice to see. And also, in the video background, they have all of the English footage and all that. So it's kind of nice to see how all of that's coming together. And also with that, Atlus USA is still putting out character trailers and just mechanic trailers, kind of similar to how they did in Japan before the game came out. Just minute-long videos, not even sometimes, just showing off stuff that we've mostly seen before if you follow the Japanese trailers, but English voice acting, yay. Other video clips, though, this is also kind of anti-news in that there's just like really nothing to this story, but it's kind of semi-noteworthy. We've been getting some break record video clips, really, really short stuff. Just on, me and Mystic slightly touched on it, I think, last episode, but Atlus has just been showing some really, really small break record stuff. And I mean, like, I'm talking 30-second trailers. 30-second
trailers that are, like, really uninspired, in my
opinion.
They have no hype.
It's basically been stuff that's from the DS game, but it looks better because it's the 3DS, so it's sharper. There's character trailers that are 30 seconds, and it's like, hey, there's voice acting, and the portraits
look better. Yeah,
they're
just showing off the voice acting and how better the portraits look, and a little bit of the animated cutscenes.
Yeah, and the animated cutscenes are kind of semi there, too. They haven't even really shown off stuff from the additional scenario yet, honestly. Like, we've seen, like, bits and pieces, but it's not enough to even talk about, really. Like,
There's still people complaining that Shoji Meguro is doing music for the extra scenario.
I think that's... Oh, whatever. People are dumb. Yeah. People also seem to really not understand. Meguro can do more than just the J-pop stuff.
Have people ever listened to Nocturne?
Meguro was behind...
He was behind Nocturne, Digital Devil Saga, Raido.
Did he do Raido? He did
stuff for Raido.
Okay.
He did some Soul Hackers music.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he was doing music, like, way back.
When I think of Meguro, I think of Nocturne, DDS, Persona 3 and 4.
Yeah.
Those are the four. Goddamn, Nocturne's OST is so good.
It's amazing.
It's really good. DDS, actually. Just DDS is great, too. Just, nice stuff. All around with that. But, yeah, I think it's stupid people are complaining about that. It's whatever. I guess that's it for break record news. There's not much break record news, and I guess the game's coming out in 2 months, so we'll probably get more stuff next month and into January. I think it's January 29th that game comes out in Japan.
In Japan.
In Japan. So, hey, actually, speaking of that, a few of the gameplay we saw was from the Japanese TGS, what the fuck am I saying? The Japanese Nintendo Direct that was just recently.
They just recycled footage?
It wasn't recycled footage, but it was just main missions and, like, some of the early day one stuff and day two stuff from the original game. Like, hey, here's how you move around the map, and it really wasn't anything.
Here's how you move around the map.
Yeah,
just press this button and you can go forward.
It was a Nintendo Direct thing, so it's like, this is what this game is and when you can expect to buy it, and please be interested in it. So
please be excited.
So yeah, nothing too much. And then, unfortunately, I was watching that Nintendo Direct hoping, like, oh man, break record localization announcement, break record localization announcement. Oh,
nothing happened.
Majora's Mask 3D is fine too.
Yeah, that's
fine. Actually, Majora's Mask 3D was actually why I was okay. I'm like, okay, break record localization announcement isn't yet. I'm fine with this because Majora's Mask 3D is a thing that exists. So
it's a thing that really exists. It went beyond just a tech demo.
Oh my god, that was amazing. You know what? I had a realization the other day regarding Majora's Mask. So I think I've talked about this on the podcast before, where I played Majora's Mask when I was a kid, and just, I'm like, okay, this game is fun and all that. It's another Zelda. Yay, I like it, whatever. Then I went back to Majora's Mask when I was a little bit older, like not super old, just like maybe 13, 14. I don't remember the exact age, but like either early high school or like... No, actually, not even early high school. It was, like, sometime in middle school. And just, I realized how fucked up and strange the game was. And I'm just like, wow, this is actually a lot darker. And I just kind of, I was old enough and mature enough to understand some of the implications with some of the dialogue. And I'm like, fuck, this game is creepy. I like it. And it kind of just became my favorite Zelda from then on out. Because I'm like, how did this game not emotionally traumatize me as a kid?
Everything just went over your head.
And you know... I'm glad you say that, because that's exactly what I want to segue into. I think the by default creepiest and most fucked up part of Majora's Mask actually did go over my head until literally just a few days ago. So I guess the easiest way for me to describe this, you know, when you're a kid and there's something strange in just in life in general, but you kind of grow up with it and it's kind of just always there. So you never realize how fucking weird it is until you get older and kind of take a step back and you go, whoa, that's really fucking weird. So I was on Google Images and I was just looking at the moon's face and I'm like, that moon has a face, and it's really fucking creepy. How the fuck did I never notice this before? When I was a kid, and even on my second playthrough when I was older, the moon never really bothered me, and I was never really creeped out by it, and I never even thought it was that creepy until a few days ago. I'm just staring into the moon's face on Google Images at, like, 1 in the morning, and I'm just sitting there for, like, a minute, and I'm like, that's a pretty fucked up face.
That's creepy, bro.
That's pretty too spooky. I just never noticed before, and I'm like,
too spoopy.
It took me until like now to just finally take a step back and go, wow, the Majora's Mask moon is fucking creepy. Yeah, just the most obvious thing just kind of went over my head until recently. Everything else about the game disturbed me, but the moon, that's fine. Majora's Mask, you're a great game, that one. Anyways, we're way off topic. So more news. Persona 3 movie news. Third movie, also known as Persona 3, the movie number 3, Falling Down, is coming out in Japanese theaters spring 2015.
Yeah, I know, it was weird, right? Fall coming out in spring. Gosh.
You know, that is actually kind of funny because like us, no, because actually that's weird. Spring of Birth came out in fall. Midsummer's Night Dream actually got lucky because that came out in the summer. And then Falling Down is coming out in the spring. I would not be surprised if...
Winter came out in summer?
Actually, no, I think it might be safe to say I think Winter could come out December, January of 2016. Oh. Like December 2015, maybe January 2016, who knows. And also... I guess most important for us Western fans, the second movie, Midsummer's Night Dream's home release is March 11th, which I'm assuming it's going to come with English subtitles like Spring of Birth did. If not, there will be English subtitle versions floating around probably a couple days or maybe a week or two after. Thanks, Internet. So, yeah, come in March, we'll be able to watch that second Persona 3 movie. I heard good things, it seems. So apparently it's fan service-y, so you creepy waifu people can be all over it. And then there's not much else to talk about other than a few interviews. So there was recently a translation posted on Tumblr that I found through someone posted the link to the little Tumblr post on our MegaTen. Thank you, whoever that was. This is an interview from the Shin Megami Tensei Final Story official replay novel, from to which I understand it's kind of like a player's guide, but then also they include a little bit of development notes and just interviews with the staff members and stuff. And it's just kind of an interview about overall just stuff about the game in general. And it's kind of interesting to see where they had a lot of the staff members actually talk about stuff they didn't like about the game. About SMT1, rather, and just what they want to improve on for SMT2, and it's just really interesting to see some of these early ideas thought out. And also, I fucking laughed my ass off because there's a point where one of the... hold on, let me control F real quick. So there's a point where this dude is hyping up Last Bible, and it's the most fucking funny thing ever because he's like... I'm now working on Last Bible on the Game Boy, and it is, so to speak, a book of Genesis for Megami Tensei. Which I think it's fucking hilarious because like it seems to really want to hype this game up, and it was garbage. Last Bible fucking sucks.
Hot steamy booty.
But like I just love how just in here he sneaks it in, like you can think of Last Bible as the book of Genesis as Shin Megami Tensei.
That's pretty up there.
I'm just thinking of some Japanese kid reading this, like, oh, I need to buy it now.
I need to buy this.
Last Bible sounds like it's going to be the best video game of all time. This is going to put MegaTen on the map.
It's the origin story. And actually, there's a point in here that made me go kind of, aw. And actually, it's actually the paragraph right after that. And this is from Hideyuki, I think his name is. He's one of the directors. And he wrote, after Shin Megami Tensei, I'm thinking I want to turn its sequels and all the other games that will follow into the most popular titles of the game industry at the end of the century. Didn't quite make that, but, I mean, MegaTen had its place by the... It had a solid enough following in Japan, especially, and even it was lucky enough, I guess it wasn't the most big thing in the game industry like he wanted, and let's be honest, that's a little unreasonable of an expectation, but, it got pretty damn big since SMT1. Even from these early interviews, you can kind of just feel how small the team was, and then even if you compare... By 2000, they had Persona stuff out, they had the Devil Summoner games, they had a reasonable following. Some of their games even came out west. They found a very, very small market there. So, kind of cool to see just the stuff back then and all that. Actually, there's a few interviews that are just kind of talking about SMT, I think specifically Megami Tensei 1 and 2 and SMT 2 in general, with some of the early Atlus team members that were... Tumblr posts too, just translations of interviews that were really interesting. It's actually really fascinating to go back and see their mindset with some of these earlier games and just kind of the messages they wanted to convey with the games or just their ideas. Even in here, there's a few stuff that surprised me, or a bit of stuff that surprised me rather. The first thing right off the bat, actually, it's the start of the interview. So one of the early writers, which actually he worked on Megami Tensei 1 and 2, it seems like as well, or maybe just Megami Tensei 2, I can't quite remember, but Ito, he was kind of influential in the early mainline games and their stories. And Ito said that one of the things that he really didn't think go well with SMT1's story was Law Hero. Which yeah. I think is really interesting because most people actually like Law Hero more than Chaos Hero when they play it, just because Law Hero is actually kind of a nice guy, and he only... It's not even really explicitly said that he turns evil because he's an asshole. They kind of leave it up to interpretation if he just got hypnotized by God or not. And what he said is the Chaos Hero unintentionally became too emotional, while Law Hero ended up sounding fake, which is,
That's interesting.
That is, because the Chaos Hero you do kind of feel bad for, because he really gets trashed on by gang members, and is really...
Yeah.
He's kind of socially awkward, and just kind of... He tries really hard to be badass, kind of because he's insecure and gets picked on a lot. But yeah, the Law Hero
feels like Chaos Hero is a lot more relatable than Law Hero.
In a way, yeah. Chaos Hero is much more of an asshole, and he's kind of always an asshole, but like Law Hero is just a nice stand-up dude until he, spoiler alert for an old ass game, until he dies and then is resurrected, where he goes straight up law and then he becomes an evil prick. Before that, he's a pretty nice dude that maybe says something off here or there. It's almost kind of like Jonathan, except I'd say Jonathan is more of an ass than Law Hero was.
Jonathan was just too zealous for his own good.
Yeah, and with Law Hero, some people even read it as just he wasn't evil. God just made him evil after he died and brought him back to use as a tool. So I thought that was really interesting because it seems from the Western perspective's fan base, more people like Law Hero than Chaos Hero, at least in terms of liking the character. In terms of character arc, Chaos Hero probably has a stronger arc and like better writing, so I guess from that perspective I think people like Chaos Hero more because he's more interesting, but in terms of like, oh, he's a nice guy, I think more people like Law Hero. And then also just there's a few things in here with just like
before in Japan Chaos Hero is more popular.
I wouldn't be surprised. Well, I think Chaos Hero is more popular here just because he's more badass, but Chaos Hero is probably one of my favorite Megaton characters, honestly. Actually, one thing that I think is kind of cool is that in here they're kind of like, so what are you thinking about for the next game? And he says like kind of like an Old Testament style story that kind of goes into just more stuff with like the apocalypse and God's judgment and all that. And I'm like, oh, so that's where the killing God thing comes in SMT 2. So you can kind of see the ideas planted early on and all that fun stuff. And then a little bit from Kaneko and all that too. So just really overall a good interview. And I'm going to link to this one and then just some other interviews that I've been able to find that have been translated. Thanks a lot to all the people that actually find these and like translate these.
I know it must have been really, really difficult to find complete interviews after all these years.
Yeah, these are from like the 90s. These are going way back. Like
Back in time.
Yeah, shout outs to everyone that's been able to do this. Like, you guys are awesome. It's actually really, really cool that the Western fan base gets our hands on this kind of stuff, because just early MegaTen stuff, like, finding info on a lot of these earlier games in English is a fucking nightmare. I still can't tell you too much about Majin Tensei 1 as a game. Like, I know it exists, and I kind of know the plot. I couldn't tell you anything about that game's development. Like, stuff like that, it's just kind of interesting when we finally get tidbits like this translated. So, yep, good stuff. I'm going to link to it below. But we had another interview, which is actually in English and I'd say more contemporary.
Yes, this is actually pretty important.
This is kind of, yeah, actually I'd say it's pretty important. And actually by contemporary, I mean it came out actually fucking today as of recording. And it's actually the Atlus CEO's first European interview, which is pretty cool stuff and hopefully a sign of good things to come given recent trends. Naoto Hirooka, I'm hoping I'm pronouncing that right.
CEO.
I cannot pronounce any of these Japanese names. I always feel bad, but please pardon my mispronunciations whenever they come up. The Atlus CEO had a European interview with a website, and there's just, I guess, kind of nothing major in here, but just some interesting stuff talking about designing games and the difference between platform you're designing for and just kind of the audience you go for. Mm-hmm. And there was one really, really one quote from this whole article, and I read the full thing. This one quote from the article really stuck out to me throughout the whole thing, and just I kept coming back to it and thinking about it, because just I feel like this is something everyone kind of knew already, but just kind of to have the Atlus CEO actually go out and say it was, you know, it's like, I guess, kind of just hammering the point home. There is a point in the interview early on where they're talking about Persona 3.
Yeah.
And this quote comes up. Up until then, when we would develop a game in Japan, it was very much what we would want to do as a company. We would want to make a game, and we would make the game the way we wanted to and do it a certain way. That was always how we had done things up until that point. Persona 3 represented something different for us. It was the first time where we decided to look at things overall and think more about the consumers and what the consumer might be looking for in a game. That's how that game was developed and then released. So, sure enough, that's part... I'm right there. That explains the boom. Persona 3 was... And you can see it in the game.
Yeah, you can... It's pretty obvious how that turned out.
If you play Digital Devil Saga and then Persona 3, and then you look at both of those games back-to-back, it's pretty obvious Persona 3 definitely developed with a mass audience appeal in mind over something like Nocturne or Digital Devil Saga. Definitely much more, I guess, accessible, just as, not even as a game, but just as a piece of media. It's a lot... I mean, Persona 3 is out there, don't get me wrong, but it's not...
It's not too out there where the average Joe will be turned away by the game.
Because, like, Persona 3, yeah, Persona 3 definitely, I think, is something that people can get into just as a concept versus even Digital Devil Saga, where it's like, oh, hey, there's these characters with no emotions, and then they turn into demons, and they need to eat friends to survive, and, like...
And the average person would be like, ew, I don't want to play that.
It was like, what the fuck is this? I don't get this. It's something about why is this cat here? Why is it raining all the time?
I don't understand.
Yeah, so like...
I do not comprehend.
I do not comprehend, Gale says, playing the game about he and his friends. So yeah, just that was kind of interesting to just have the CEO straight up say, like, yeah, we cared more about a mass appeal with this one. And I mean, we can't argue that totally paid off for them.
It paid off, and I think that's what Atlus's direction has been since then.
And I think it's interesting, too, because you're definitely... You can feel it in the atmosphere with just the fan base in general. There's definitely a sort of conflict going on where people are kind of nervous about the future of Megami Tensei and things like difficulty and even some of the storytelling aspects and just finding that proper balance between keeping the hardcore fans that have been here for a while happy with the older stuff and also being able to draw in more people and just overall... In a time when developing games is risky as fuck, and either we're in a point with game development where if you're not huge AAA or you're not like indie, you're kind of in this weird nebulous zone where it's really risky to even do shit. And even nowadays, AAA game development is not always the most fucking profitable because it's just so expensive.
It's not even the most quality of games anymore.
Because like they focus on elements like they have such a focus on just wrong aspects of games, and just QA testing isn't always up to par.
It seems like they just want to push the game out right before the holiday rush so they can make a quick buck.
That's definitely part of it too. Like if you look at let's be relevant and actually talk about modern game news. Yay,
Assassin's Creed.
Hey,
look at those.
I like how you thought exactly what I was.
Assassin's Creed and Sonic Boom are two prime examples of Western game development's decline in 2014.
Assassin's Creed Unity is so fucking obvious a case of, hey, we release an Assassin's Creed every November.
So we're going to release this one November and people are going to buy it.
People are going to buy it. And just a game is a glitchy hellhole, and just... AAA development is there's a lot of like these weird parameters like that you kind of need to abide by, where it's like we need to get the game out now this time, and like just stuff like that where just development isn't as safe as it used to be, and it's not as profitable as it used to be. Also because everyone wants to be the next Call of Duty, so everyone inflates their budgets to unreasonable stuff, and then you have shit like Tomb Raider, where it sells millions upon millions of copies, if I recall, and Square Enix goes, oh, it was a failure.
Yeah.
Because they didn't make the money that they wanted to.
That was fun. It leads me to be a tad worried about Final Fantasy 15, but not really. Because with 15, you can feel the passion that the development team has for the game, with just the way they've been talking about it recently. They're just like they're just really excited for it. And they really appreciate the fan support, and it gives them strength during crunch time.
I mean, Atlus 2 is definitely in this spot where they're, I guess you could say,
they're being fueled by the fans.
Well, not even just that, but I'm talking more so like I guess you could say they're in that AAA place. Kind of, they're not indie by any means. They're just
they're not
like
indie. They're like they're kind of borderline AAA. Like Persona's now.
Yeah,
damn, you're a household name.
And I mean, they publish stuff that gets fucking huge, like Demon's Souls and just Dragon's Crown. Like they're that medium-sized developer. They're not small anymore by any means, but they're not on the top level either, with like the Activision and the Ubisoft and the BioWare, you know, all of them.
I feel like if Persona 5 turns out to be one of the most amazing games of this generation, it could probably tip them over.
Oh, Persona 5.
Soft AAA.
Persona 5, if there's any games that pushes Atlus into being bigger, it's going to be Persona 5. That game is going to... I mean, that game's release conditions are just so right, where like the fan base is excited. Golden just brought in a shit ton of new people. Everyone's talking about it. Final Fantasy and Dragon Quest have been tripping over their own feet for like God knows how fucking long now. Well, Dragon Quest is actually fine in Japan, but
it's fine in Japan, but it's a dead man walking in North America and
in North America, they just don't fucking just bring Dragon Quest 7 for 3DS over already. Why haven't you? Like
because sales. You know Dragon Quest IX sold like hotcakes.
Like the DS versions of Dragon Quest 4 through 6 were so popular too, and like whatever. Like it's just stupid. It's really dumb. Like but yeah, just in the West it's kind of this perfect storm where Persona 4 brought people in, and then people are talking about it, and just there's not many other options if you want a good JRPG anymore. Like,
it's they're in that really sweet spot where they can like release Persona 5, make it, if Persona 5 is good, they're in there. Like they're literally,
yeah,
they're literally probably going to be AAA or AAA quality in terms of games, because Western developers are like tripping all over themselves now. And releasing half-baked games, people were sick and tired of seeing Western games just coming out as glitchy messes.
It's really the heart of the problem is everyone wants to be the next Call of Duty because shareholders and just like the higher ups go, well, they can make that game be really popular and all that if they do all this marketing stuff and all this.
Can you just imagine like Persona 5 like sells damn near Call of Duty level, and now you see Ubisoft trying to make a Persona clone?
Assassin's Creed High School.
Yes. They just start, everyone tries all the way.
That is the most unfortunate implication a title can have. Creed High School.
Can you just imagine if, like, all the Western developers try to ride on their Persona success and they just fail miserably?
That will probably never happen, but that'd be fucking beautiful. But, like, yeah.
Oh, my God. That'll be, like,
the issue with that is just, like, the budgets are too big now for games, and like no one can ever sell enough copies to just get the money back that they spent making the damn thing, which is just unfortunate. But I mean, Atlus isn't even too bad with that, because Atlus knows how to use their money well. Look at their games.
Their games are pretty small in scale.
Well, like, that's the thing, though. They really aren't, like, asset-wise, they are, but, like, they're huge games. They know how to stretch their resources. Yeah. But that being said, Atlus is in this weird place where it's like they, you know, I mean, even just if you look at the thing with Index falling under and all that, like, they're not in the most, like, in terms of their place in the game development world and just, like, as a company, they're kind of in, like, a fragile place, even with, like, Sega owning them, you never know. Like, a few bad games would be bad news for them, like, financially type of thing.
I think even one bad game is enough to set them back.
Enough, probably.
Yeah.
Luckily, their games are pretty damn good. But like, even if you look at it, they have plenty of reason to want to be more accessible with stuff like SMT4 or even Persona Q having like the baby mode. Or actually, Break Record, they're introducing, what they're doing now is there's two difficulty modes that I think roughly translate to Gospel, which is like baby hand holding mode, and Apocalypse, which is the original game's difficulty. I really hope they rebalance some of those boss fights in Apocalypse, but whatever. If they don't, whatever. I wish they would, but whatever. Like, they have incentive to want to bring new people in and just make these games more accessible to get more money, just so they're in a bit more of a safe place. And, I mean, Atlus doesn't have the most money in the world, so definitely getting more people in would be helpful towards that. But then, like I said, you run into this thing where it kind of alienates some of the old fans, and that's always not the best. So, who knows with that. It'll be interesting to see how they kind of compromise in the future. And I think part of the problem, and I've talked with some friends about this, I think inherently, as a franchise, I don't think MegaTen as a whole, by its very nature, is the most accessible thing. I don't think MegaTen, no matter what you do to it, I don't think MegaTen is something for everyone.
Yeah.
Even stuff like Persona 4 Golden is still,
there's still people who don't want to play the game because it's too, quote-unquote, too Japanese and too anime.
Yeah, it's this weird sort of, like,
Even though everyone's like, yeah, Persona 4 Golden's like the best game on a Vita, it's the only game on a Vita that you'll ever need. You need to buy this game.
Still,
it's the game of the year. This is like one of the best games out there, and they're like, it's too Japanese.
Or, like, even not only that, it's like, it's the weird RPG thing and all. Like, oh, I need, what are all these Persona thingies? And, like, it's just, not, by its very nature, it's not something for everyone. And it's never probably going to be, unless they just completely overhaul the thing. But at that point, is it really even Megaten anymore? You know? So. And, I mean, even SMT4, a lot of people shat on it because it was easy and all that. I mean, it's still a damn fine game, but, like, it brought in new people and kind of got the job done, so it'll be interesting to see if they are able to keep some of the more hardcore elements intact as we go forward, or if it's just going to get less and less you know, good for the hardcore crowd as things go on. One thing, though, that I think was interesting is apparently Persona Q actually pretty damn hard from everyone I know that's played of it. Those higher difficulties get fucking hard, and, like, it's a good hard, like, Megaten hard. Except the only thing I want to say with that is that that game is made by the Etrian Odyssey team, so hopefully that's a sign not just for Etrian Odyssey but for Megaten in general, but who knows. Hopefully Persona 5 is has some higher difficulty stuff for those of us that want to partake in that, but who knows. But yeah, that's really all I wanted to talk about with that. I thought it was pretty damn interesting how they went with that. I need to actually get going soon, but I guess we can do... Fuck it, I'm just going to do, like, two emails. Okay. We almost reached it already, but I actually need to go pretty soon. But here's an email. Okay, so this one's from Sonia, and she says, "Hello, it's me again. Once again, your podcast is really nice to listen to, especially when I'm working on other things at the same time. Thanks.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, here are some questions for you, and I hope they are not repeats. One, if you could add any modern demon / spirit / whatever to a demon compendium, who would you add and why? I thought about this the other day, and the only one I could think of is Bloody Mary, but I would like to know what you guys might add. I don't know if we've answered this before. I feel like we have,
but oh. I just can't remember.
Like, it's pretty complete. I think Bloody Mary actually is in Persona 1.
Oh, really?
I think, yeah, I'm gonna... To the Megami Tensei Wiki we go.
To the Megaten Wiki!
Yo, fun fact, I'm in a Megaten game. Look up Rasen on the Megami Tensei Wiki. It's a little spiral thingy that was in... Demi Kids, something or other. One of the Devil Children games. Persona has Bloody Mary.
Oh, well, there you go.
So, I don't know in terms of other stuff I'd add. Like, they have a lot of bases covered. Definitely. So, and I feel like we've answered that before, and then, like, every single time we say something, someone points out, actually, that demon exists in this one game, you just never knew it. I'm like, oh.
Well.
Okay, so second question. You, for some reason, have access to the demon summoning program via your computer or an app or something. You can summon demons via this program whenever you want, but the world isn't in any danger, so there isn't a need to fight other people than demons. Which three demons would you have with you at all times, and what would you have them do for you?
What demons I want with me?
Three, if you have three, and there's no need to fight anything.
Just have them for the sake of having them around?
Yeah.
I'll let you go first.
Fuck. Kodama, just because he's a little goober, fly around, float around the wind. Actually, you know what? Kodama might be a bad idea, because you're just kind of taking him out for a walk, and there's a breeze, and he flies away, never to be seen again. So probably, let's see, Jack Frost, because he's Jack Frost, and, like, if
he's totally not a demon that could probably just kill you. Have you forgotten about Digital Devil Saga 2 already?
Oh my god, that is the best fucking boss fight in any of the Megaten games. It's just straight up Jack Frost. Like, not even, like, it's just Jack Frost.
Yeah, it's just Jack Frost trying to kill you.
It's actually just a Jack Frost that's, like, level 80 trying to kill you.
Yes.
Fucking Digital Devil Saga does that so good. Let's see. If Jack Frost pissed me off too much, I could just make a snow cone out of him and it'd be fine. Pixie, because healing, I guess. Actually, you know what? Any, like, healer demon, so, like, Super Pixie, I guess. And then... another demon. Mastema, because why not? Just chill around and for the lulls.
Chill around and plot things. It could be a sitcom.
I just want to real talk. I just want Mastema in my face, just so I can be like, "What the fuck are you doing?" Like, no one knows why you're here in any of these games. And like,
I want Mastema to be a persona in Persona 5. Put Mastema in Persona 5 when you start a campaign. Mastema.
Speaking of Mastema, hey, I'm streaming Strange Journey now.
Yeah. You're gonna see a lot of them.
So yeah, whenever you see me streaming, I'll have my Twitch. I always have my Twitch below. But yeah, if you catch me streaming Strange Journey, feel free to jump in and watch. It'll be a fun time. Oh, and also, some people have been major fans of my SMT1 Let's Play that I do. So it turns out, like, 2 hours of the footage for that, just something with the codec, and I don't know if it happened while I was like changing
computers.
Yeah, like, yeah. While I was changing computers, like moving the files around, or just something weird happened where there is a couple hours that I had recorded on the old computer with this codec that was better than the one I was using, and it just straight up corrupted the video files, and like I just lost a bunch of progress, and I don't feel like replaying it. So what I'm like, fuck it. What I'm just going to do instead is I'm just going to drop the Let's Play and then stream SMT1 instead, which might be slightly more inconvenient to watch just because like it's more random encounters and stuff, but like I don't have the time to do all that editing again, because like a lot of those SMT1 Let's Play videos are like actually about an hour or two worth of recording cut down into 20 to 30 minute episodes, because yeah, it's a lot of editing on my part, and just losing all of that work, I'm like, I don't feel like replaying, because my backup save was actually an hour or two behind that, so it's more like 3 or 4 hours that I lost overall that I need to play back through, and I just don't have the time or patience for that. So I'll probably be streaming Shin Megami Tensei 1 and Strange Journey back to back, and also maybe I dicked around with Dark Souls, and I might do that more. I'm not sure yet. Just if I feel like it, I will. So yeah, that's enough self-promotion whoring on my end. Back to this email. So yeah, Jack Frost, Super Pixie, Mastema, Katsu, you pick your three.
Let's see. Pixie, because Pixie is bae. Let's see. Pixie. Probably Yamato Takeru. He seems like a pretty cool guy. Pretty cool neutral guy. And let's see, one more. We need to have like a demon that's pretty much like a mascot. It's not very smart. It's just there. Yeah, I'll probably go with Jack Frost too.
That feel.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, I'm going to actually, oh wait, nope, there's part of the email I didn't read. That's all I have for now. I hope you guys have a fantastic week and stuff. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a fantastic week too and all that. So yeah, that's that was Sonia. Thanks a lot. Another email quick before I go. Oh no, what? Palms are sweaty. Short one. Where's a short one?
Knees weak, palms are sweaty, mom's spaghetti.
Oh no. I'm losing myself in the music. Where's a short one? Oh, hey, this is actually, yeah, this is relevant. So this one's from good old Jeremy, and he says, first and foremost, love the podcast, of course. Favorite of the few SMT/Persona casts out there. Ha!
Ha! Take that!
We are the number one podcast. Straight up. Yes. Jeremy confirmed. Anyways, so Jeremy says, any updates on getting the RSS feed up to date? The MP3 download links are okay for offline listening, but to get it all on a feed would be sublime. So, Jeremy, I have good news for you. Sort of good, bad news. Okay, so to get everyone up to speed on our situation with being a legitimate podcast and not just relying on YouTube and MP3 download links like some ghetto-ass shitty production that we are. We're a ghetto-ass shitty production, let's be serious here.
We are.
We're pretty trash. So I do have COS. COS is up on iTunes.
Yes.
And by COS is up on iTunes, I mean like the first 11 or so episodes. Technically a few more because there's some 0.5s in there, but It is totally up on iTunes, and just one of these days I was like, I'm going to put all of the episodes back up. I'm just going to put all of them on iTunes and have them all properly labeled and whatnot and make sure they all work fine and all that, and just spend a whole day doing that. And just, I put it off, and then we did more episodes, and I put it off, and we did more episodes. So I got to a point now where I'm like, I don't want to archive all of those. So what I think I'm going to do is, starting with episode 51, which is going to be the first episode of season 3, because every 25 episodes we do another podcast season. Yes. So
what's season 3 going to be called?
My original idea was Good Katsu, I'm Burning Rasen. I was going to rip off a Coheed and Cambria album with a shitty name, but then the playlist title was too long, and YouTube's like, you can't do that. And I'm like, fuck you, Google. So we need to figure out something real quick for that season 3 title.
Podcast tuner there.
No, it's too easy. We can't just do a Megaten thing like that. We need to do something special and dumb.
Dragon Podcast Z.
I don't know why that's so funny. And this is to go even further beyond. No, but yeah, I think starting with season 3, I'm just, as soon as I upload the episodes and get the MP3 download, I'm just going to put it up on iTunes as well. So sorry for being such a slow, lazy loser with updating that, because I know there's a lot of people actually that like the podcast and are just really fucking pissed because iTunes is their most convenient podcasting option, and we haven't been serving that crowd of our fans too well. So
whoops,
couple episodes from now, guys, I swear we'll start putting 51 and onwards, it'll all go up on iTunes. I'll make the effort, because it's about damn time we do that and stop being shitty sticklers with that. So yeah, that's all on my end. Sorry about that. Anyways, yeah, thanks, Jeremy. You're a very convenient last question for me to explain a future plan that I had coming up, and for your kind words and stuff. So yeah, I think that's it. And like I said, I actually need to get going. I'm running late. Fuck. Anyways, yeah, bye everyone.
Later. Like the sun is not like the fuck, whenever it's dark, you keep on blinking at me. You never turn away from me in this past gloomy night sky. Like the fire up in the night, the journey that we travel for our prize. No matter where we go, we win. Not the best shining forever. Gather demons and come again.